Today is March 13th, 2014, and we are interviewing Charles Hoelscher.
Hoelscher.
Excuse me. At Effingham DAV Club. Mr. Hoelscher was born January 7th, 1949. And my name is Cheryl Walker, and I'll be the interviewer. Mr. Hoelscher, could you state for the record what war and branch of service you served in?
Okay, I was in the United States Navy from 1971 till 1977.
Okay, and what was your highest rank?
My highest rank was a lieutenant in the Navy.
Okay, and at this point, would you like to start and give us your history and your story?
Okay, I can just kind of go in chronological order. Anything you see or hear that you might want to talk about more, just go ahead and interrupt me.
Okay.
I signed up for the Navy in 1971, entered Aviation Officer Candidate School. November the 1st, 1971, went through the Aviation Officer Candidate School, which is basic training for a commissioned officer, for a commissioned flight officer. I finished that. I think that was a 90-day period. They call them the 90-day wonder still, I think. And while we're in the basic training, we were referred to as poopies. And they still refer to them to this day as poopies while they're in the Aviation Officer Candidate School. After AOCS, I went to Training Squadron 1. I was going to be a pilot for the Navy. Training Squadron 1 was your basic flight training for getting commissioned as a flight officer in the Navy. And that was in Pensacola, Florida, and the training squadron was VT-1. After VT-1 in the Pensacola, I went to VT-2, which was a secondary advanced flight training for the Navy. We flew the North American T-28 Trojan airplane. It was a single engine, radial engine. That was our advanced single engine trainer. After I finished that in Pensacola, I went to a training squadron in Corpus Christi, Texas for multi-engine training. And there I flew the Grumman S2 Tracker, which is also known as the Stoof, S-T-O-O-F. That was its nickname. And it was a twin-engine radial airplane, and it was a type that was based aboard the carrier, and when you landed, the wings folded up on top of each other. You might have seen some of the older movies. After the training squadron in Corpus Christi, we came back to Pensacola, Florida, and I underwent the aircraft carrier landing qualification. And that was in VT-5 in Pensacola. And our class name there was, class number was 18-1. We were known as the Hellcats, H-E-L-L-C-A-T-S. And I did my training based on land at first at some old airports around Pensacola, old military bases. Then when we got to the qualifying part, we flew out about 50 miles into the Pensacola Bay and did our landing qualifications aboard the USS Lexington. And there I did two touch and goes initially, land on the deck, take off again. Then I came back and did six full stop landings. Then after that, we all launched again in formation flight, went back to Pensacola, and shortly after that, I was awarded my Navy Wings of Gold, which I'm very proud of. After Naval Air Training Command, after I got my commission as an ensign, I was based in the Naval Air Station, Patuxent River, Maryland, and there I underwent training for the P-3 operational aircraft. The P-3 was a four-engine turboprop. It was a sub hunter, and did my qualification there for that aircraft. And after that was assigned to, this is going to be a long word, Ferry Conron 2 Squadron in Rota, Spain. And that stands for Fleet Air Reconnaissance Squadron 2. We were based in Rota, Spain for 3 years. I flew the EP-3E Ares aircraft. It was a highly developed, state-of-the-art electronic surveillance aircraft. It had a big radar dish on the belly, and on the top of the airplane was a multitude array of sophisticated electronic equipment. And we listen to land-based radars, missile sites. We monitored communications of all sorts. And our track, or our mission, was to fly off the coast of, usually flew a certain mileage off the coast of North Africa. Usually started out at Algeria, went all the way east to the Sinai Peninsula, turned north, and flew up as far as Turkey and came back. That was our track. That was from 1973 to 1976. And while I was in the Ferry Conron 2 in Rota, Spain, our logo for our airplane was there's a Sandy Man bodega, as it's called. It's a winery. What Spain is known for a lot of their wines and sherries and things like this. This was a sherry producer, and the logo was called the Sandy Man. This is the actual logo of the bodega or the winery, and we adopted that for our logo on the tail of our aircraft. And it was a symbol of a Spaniard in a big black cape and a big black hat, and he had his arm across his face like this, so it looked like a spy to us. We put it on our airplane, with their permission, I hope. Do you want some points of interest that happened during the squadron, things like that?
Yes, okay. Please.
That was our primary mission, was to fly those missions. We flew all the other missions as far west as the Azores Islands over the Atlantic Ocean. Our primarily based, as I said, was along the Mediterranean coast of the North Africa and the Middle East countries. We also flew missions up in the Baltic Sea along the Russian coast. And I did fly one trip down to Key West, Florida from Spain. We stopped at the Azores, fueled up, and did the rest of the trip on down to Key West, Florida, and did some support of our operations down there around Cuba for a couple of days. Then flew back to Rota, Spain again. That was a long mission, but a lot of fun. As I said, I was in that squadron from 1973 to 1976. As a junior officer in the squadron, I happened to be on patrol one day in October 1973 when Egypt and Israel went to war with each other. We were out flying our patrol. We saw a lot of contrails over the Sinai Peninsula, and we didn't have the big picture. We didn't know what was going on. At one point, we got a call from our headquarters. I was a co-pilot at the time, they requested that we state our position immediately. And I called back on the radio, said, "Stand by, I will encode the message and get right back to you." And they hastily said, "Negative, negative. State latitude, longitude, unencoded, immediately." So I gave them our position. About a minute later, they came back and replied, "Okay, message received, continue mission." We got back and I asked what that was all about. And they said they had the word from another source during the conflict between Egypt and Israel that there was an Israeli F-4 coming out to shoot us down. And I said, "Well, thanks for the warning. You know, I wish we would have known that back then." They said, "Well, you were headed away from the conflict, and they computed he didn't have enough gas to get out to us, shoot us down, plus get back to base. So they figured we were safe." I said, "Well, why would they want to shoot us down?" He says, "You don't understand how Israel works. They go out, they clear the neighborhood, they apologize later. That's how they survive." Another operation, and on another mission, we got another message from our headquarters, and they said evasive immediately. And our evasive maneuvers to get away, get down to the 200 feet off the ocean as quickly as possible and escape in a neutral direction. So we had that happen one time. Another time I was flying out of Wiesbaden, Germany on a mission up to the Baltic Sea. And on takeoff, we were fully loaded. Number 3 engine took a bird when we were taken off, And I was a co-pilot at the time, and the captain said, secure the engine, secure the engine. I said, negative, we're still putting out enough power. Keep her going. So we took off, and we're pretty low for a while. We finally gained enough speed and got back. Landed in Frankfurt, Germany. The mechanic came up and said, which one of you is the funny guy? And I said, what do you mean? He came walking up and threw a tree branch in our lap. He said, I found this in your wheels. So that was a pretty close call. And then as the skinniest officer on board, and we had to go in and take the bird out of the engine. I took a coat hanger, bent the hook on it. Two guys held me by my legs and put me in the inlet of the engine. And I had a flashlight and a coat hook, and I hooked on the bird and pulled him out. And the engine was fried, so we couldn't use it, and we had to ferry it back to Rota, Spain for maintenance and an engine change. Another thing that happened in VQ2, as the squadron was known, Ferry Conron 2, it's, the symbols were VQ2. I was, as a junior officer, I think it was June of 1974, every junior officer rotated to the USS Forrestal, or whichever carrier was in the Mediterranean at that time. And as a junior officer, you were assigned as officer in charge of the detachment aboard the carrier, in support of our A3 aircraft, the A3 Sky Warrior, which was a two-engine ship-based reconnaissance aircraft. So I was in charge of that detachment for 34 days on the USS Forrestal, sailing around the southern Mediterranean around Cyprus. When Cyprus had trouble, Turkey and Greece were going at it, and we were evacuating citizens and stuff from over there. Time on the Forrestal was fun, if you want to call it fun. It was hot, it was miserable, it was noisy. And we were in operations 24 hours a day, and my job also was to be in the control tower with next to the air boss in case he had any questions about our shipboard aircraft. And our aircraft could stay up for 3-hour cycles, as they were called. So our plane would go up for 3 hours, circle around the Sixth Fleet, do electronic surveillance and report on anything unusual going on intelligence-wise that way, electronic intelligence. So during my time out there, I saw several things. It was I had a priority message, or anything larger than a priority message, I had to be in the communications room within 5 minutes to answer that message. Of course, the communications is all the way in the front of the ship. My bunk was back under the number 3 wire in the rear of the ship. So I became O.J. Simpson in a hurry a lot of times. If I got a call, there was a message. Excuse me. I had to race to the front of the ship to get to the communications officer in time. And about 3 times I remember almost bumping over the admiral who was on the ship at that time, the three-star admiral. One time he stopped me and he said, "Sailor," he said, "next time you come through my area, I want you to announce yourself ahead of time." So ever since after that, I had to call out, "So-and-so coming through, sir." So I wouldn't knock into him again. He got tired of being bumped into, I guess. And on the aircraft carrier, they have the hatches, you know, where they seal the compartments closed. If I got out of sync running through those hatches, I'd bang my knees on there or I'd bang my head. One or the other, sometimes both. I came away with that with permanent dents in my shins, and I had a line on my forehead when I came home. Several other times we ran out of fresh water. The, the things that make fresh water out of seawater would quit, be not operational. Have to take a shower in seawater, which is not comfortable. You itch all the time after that. This was in the middle of June on the middle of the ocean. So it was inside the ship was over 100 degrees a lot of times. And as I said, whenever our airplane was airborne on a 3-hour cycle, I had to be up in the control tower next to the air boss. Most of the other jets that were on the ship went up for hour and a half cycles. So for 24 hours a day, for almost 30 days, I had to sleep under the number 3 wire every hour and a half. Bang! An airplane would come in, land on that number three wire, which is the one they tried for. And I tried to sleep with that for 30 days, 24 hours a day. Got used to it after a while. I have fond memories of that. I don't think I'd like to do it again, but I'm glad I did at that time. A couple of sad stories, or one sad story and one good story. One time there was an F-4 coming in for a landing. I was up in the Airbus tower watching again. And the F-4 came in for a landing, missed all the wires, went over the side of the ship. And this big spray of water came up over the deck of the ship, which is, what, 60 feet above the ground. And the water was like another 60 feet above that. And we thought it was a big splash and he had crashed into water. But pretty soon we noticed the spray of water coming up over the deck of the ship was going down the length of the ship. So the air boss got all excited, got on the radio and started talking to the pilot, saying, "Walk it, walk it, walk it." Pretty soon he got far enough ahead of the ship, we could see he was in full afterburner, about 6 feet above the water, had his tail almost 90 degrees to the water, and he was walking that airplane like this on its tail. He finally got up enough speed, he got about a half a mile in front of the ship, dropped the nose, got up more speed, did a victory roll, and came back and did a perfect landing the next time. So we thought he was done for, but he saved the Navy a multi-million dollar airplane that day. But he got back to the, when he came back into the, everybody met in the wardroom or the dining room, whatever you want to call it. And he was so shook, he got to the drink machine. He had a tomato juice can about this big. He filled that thing full of Kool-Aid and just stood there and guzzled that before he could talk to anybody. That was the funny story I remember. The sad story was, I said we were doing operations 24 hours a day out there for almost 30 days. And during their operations and practice and stuff, they have designated areas where different airplanes would do their maneuvers and practice gunnery shooting, target shooting, things like that. Well, this one day, the A-7s were in this designated area doing their target shooting. Over in this area, the helicopters were doing some kind of practice operations. And of course, this happens in the military a lot of times. Two airplanes come together in their own areas, of course. But the word was the A-7 shot a missile at some target. The helicopter was too close to his designated area. The missile turned and shot down our own helicopter. Excuse me. You talk about a ship with 5,000 people. When they brought those bodies back and laid them out on the deck, it was deathly quiet. I'll tell you that. Deathly quiet. Excuse me. Then to get back to another funny story after that. We were on operations on a mission on the Baltic Sea, flying off the Russian coast. A lot of times we got intercepted by the Russians out there and they'd come up and fly beside us. I was a co-pilot again and they always pulled up on our right side, so I had a good view of the Russian pilot. And he sat there and he was just flying his jet. He just looking at us, and then you see him talking once in a while. He's probably reporting back to his headquarters. And I waved out my window, you know, just trying to be a friendly American, see if I could get some kind of reaction at him. And he just stare at me, look back straight ahead, look, stare at me, look back ahead. I never got a reaction out of him. And our radar operator, we called him Frog. That was his nickname, Frog. Don't know why to this day, but anyway, he says, "Mr. Hoelscher, you keep an eye on him. I'll see if I can get a reaction out of him." I said, "Frog, what are you going to do? Don't you do anything stupid." "Oh, well, I won't do anything stupid, sir." Pretty soon I was watching the Russian pilot, and he looked over at our window in the back behind the co-pilot seat where we had a bubble window that actually stuck out the side of the airplane. So you could stick your head out there and see all around the airplane like that. And this Russian pilot, he looked at that window. He looked back straight ahead. His eyes got bigger, and he looked again. And he looked back at this, and I just saw a strange look on his face, like he was trying to figure out what in the hell was going on. And about that time, Frog comes walking back up to the cockpit, hitching up his pants, buckling his belt. And I said, "What'd you do?" And he said, "I mooned him, sir. I mooned him." I said, "You're going to cause an international incident here, Frog." So that was a memorable occasion on that patrol. So once in a while, I wasn't all business. And shortly thereafter, the Russian pilot broke off and went back to his base. let's see. In our squadron, I think we had 600 people in our squadron in VQ-2 in Rota, Spain. I don't know how many pilots we had, but we had three aircraft types. We had the one I flew, which was the EP-3E Ares aircraft. We had the EA-3 Sky Warrior, which is a twin-engine high wing based aboard the ship. I think we had 8 P-3s, probably 6 A-3s, and then we had, I think at the most, we had 6 EC-121 Constellations, which was the old radio-powered aircraft, which were the TWA airliners back in the 30s and 40s. They were still being operational in the 1970s. So that's my experience in VQ-2 and Perry Conron 2 in Rota, Spain. After that, I requested duty in Brunswick, Maine, where I went to SEER school. I was an assistant SEER training officer. SEER is S-E-R-E. It stands for Survival, Evasion, Resistance, and Escape. There were two Navy schools for a POW survival training. The one in Brunswick, Maine was the one I reported to. Then we had another one in Warner Springs, California, outside San Diego. So I was a POW survival instructor. And the name of our detachment there was Fazo Trey Grulant, Brunswick, SEER School. Fazo Trey Grulant stands for Fleet Aviation Specialized Operational Training Group, Atlantic Fleet. So I spent, May or August of 1976, I reported there. And I got out of the service in October of 1977, so I was there almost a year and a half. And my job there was, started off being a SEER training officer. We'd have regular week-long training for POW survival. We had a camp up in the Rangeley Mountains of Northwest Maine. And we'd have the students in class for a couple days, and then we'd go up to the mountain for like a four-day event, where they got to hike through the mountains, try to escape, try to get from one point A to point B and try not to be captured. Then after we captured all of them, none of them ever got away. We knew how to run through the woods better than they did. Of course, a lot of them liked to take the easiest route, and we knew where to find like three-fourths of the class, because they'd all congregate the easiest way through the valleys and the terrain and stuff to try to reach point B. So after we got everybody rounded up, we put them into camp. We had a simulated camp, with actual isolation rooms in each building. And then it was their job to undergo a POW experience. And of course, as the instructors, we were able to safely slap them around, throw them to the ground, interrogate them. My specialty when I was there turned out to be rebound officer, is what they called it. If somebody was in danger of flunking the class, it was my job to be the bad guy still, stay in character as a bad guy, and try to knock him down farther to really deplete his confidence. Then without him realizing it, build him back up psychologically so he could be... do you call it, further able to resist or survive the POW experience, not give up. Because they just kind of gave up at one point, and they were in danger of being deleted from the class and not being given a security clearance and things like that. So I got a great deal of enjoyment out of doing that, because once I was interrogating them, knocking them down farther, building them back up psychologically, and when I saw them come up off their knees and I could see the light bulb in their head, and they're just like became the strongest resistor in the class kind of after that. And most of them, we did have several that flunked a class, but most of them survived, got through the class and the training. And that was a big source of enjoyment for me as a rebound officer, is what it was called. And of course, I got to use my experience from college. I was got a bachelor's degree in German language and Spanish language and geography. So when, during my duties as a bad guy, enemy in a POW camp, I got to make up languages pretty much. Because if I couldn't think of a word in German I had a word in Spanish or English. So I made up kind of my own language a lot of times by speaking German, Spanish, and English together. And then a couple words I picked up from like some Russian cities. Throw those in and it sounds like you're saying something bad. Also, while I was in SEER school, I got assigned extra duties in charge of a training detachment. I think there were 24 enlisted men in this detachment. And the job there was as an actual training module. It had actual cockpit, a simulated cockpit, and a simulated back end of the airplane. And this was a state-of-the-art electronic device. It actually did like simulators today. They project digital images. Back then it was all a big board on the wall with paper mache woods and trees and highways and stuff like that, and the camera followed over it. That was our state-of-the-art back then. And the back end was a training for the P3 anti-submarine warfare. I was in charge of that branch for the rest of my time in Brunswick. And then they said I was doing such a good job of being a POW instructor in charge of this training detachment, they gave me another job, of course, as much as you can handle, right? So I became the executive officer of the SEER school, the Faso Tregrulant. And there I did a lot of took a lot of the workload off of the commanding officer by doing the paperwork, the evaluations for all the enlisted, in charge of the supplies for our training for the P3 trainer and the SEER school up in the Rangeley Mountains. And I'm pretty proud of this. I got a letter of commendation from the commander of the Fleet Aviation or Fleet Training for the Atlantic Fleet. I got a letter of commendation from him. He would actually come up to the camp a couple times a year and participate as a bad guy in the SEER school POW training, because he said it gave him an escape away from the office down in Norfolk, Virginia. So that's how I got to know him, and he observed my abilities, I guess. And I'm pretty proud to say I got the high rankings on all my evaluations during my naval time. And I forgot my awards. Whenever everybody likes to see the ribbons or something or know what those are about, I only have two of those. One, when I first went into service, we got a National Defense Service Medal, which was the red ribbon or the red medal that hangs on there. And my other thing I got was a ribbon. It's called a Meritorious Unit Commendation Ribbon. And our squadron got that because we were out on patrol that day in October 1973 when Egypt and Israel went to war. And of course, after they went to war, we were highly focused. Our squadron was the center of signal and electronic intelligence for the 6th Fleet. So we got a Navy Meritorious Unit Commendation Ribbon. And I'm proud of my service. I'm glad I had a good time, experienced a lot of things, and I'm glad to participate in this project. Thank you.
Question for you.
Yes.
Why did they call you the 90-Day Wonders?
It was about a 90-day school, as I remember. And a lot of the, I don't know if the enlisted started calling everybody that or not, but after we came out of training after 90 days, I guess we were in charge of people, and they said it's a wonder probably how they can be in charge of somebody after only 90 days of training. That's my take on it.
And then you were called the Poops?
The Poopies.
The Poopies.
P-O-O-P-I-E-S.
And why were you called that?
I couldn't tell you the start of that, but we were all, I guess we were, everybody was in the same boat when they became in the AOCS, Basic Training for Aviation Officers. We wore flight suits, which are all baggy and stuff. You didn't have any military bearing wearing those. They're all baggy. Everybody ran in formation, and it's just a poopy looking outfit, I guess. Sorry about that, but that's the best explanation I can give. I never heard anything definitive. But I remember when I got out of the service, I was married. We had two daughters, and they were probably 10 and 12 at the time. We took a trip down to Pensacola, Florida. At that time, you could get on the base, you know, and tour around and stuff like that. And it took me back, and we were driving down one of the boulevards, and here was a formation of a bunch of the Poopies running. And my daughter had heard these stories before. She goes, "Dad, are those the Poopies?" And I said, "Yes, those are the Poopies." She goes, "Is that what you look like?" I said, "That's what I was, yes."
And you said that your team, and that's not the word, but were the Hellcats?
Yes, in the VT-5 training squadron for landing qualifications. I have a patch, and on it is a cat or a tiger looking thing. And he's got a helmet on, and he's got bolts of lightning coming out from the helmet, and in his teeth he's holding a tail hook from the aircraft. The tail hook's on the bottom of the airplane that grabs the wires. And the squadron insignia, he was known as the Hellcat, and our class number was 18-1. So we were Hellcats 18-1. So whenever we were out flying formation or whatever, that's the call sign we used. Hellcats 18-1.
Now, did you have a personal call?
Personal call sign, yeah.
And what was that?
Well, nobody could say my last name a lot of times. H-O-E-L-S-C-H-E-R, Hoelscher. So a lot of them just started calling me Hoelsch or Chuckles. I didn't want to be known as a military man with the name Chuckles, so I took Hoelsch, H-O-L-S-H, as my nickname. So on the back of my hat or my helmet, I had the lettering H-O-L-S-H, Hoelsch. That's what I was known as.
Now, did your family go to Spain with you?
I went to Spain first in 73. I think it was June of 73 when I reported over there. I was engaged at the time, so I came back in December 1973, married my wife, and then she came back to Spain with me for the remainder of tour duty over there. And our oldest daughter, Megan, was born over in Spain. So she has dual citizenship. She could choose to be a Spanish citizen, but she has a American citizenship. And she has a Spanish birth certificate, which she's very proud of. And as it turns out, she became a Spanish teacher in high school.
Did she?
Yes. Yeah. I say she listened to it all while she was in the womb, so she should be a good speaker, yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Now, what made you choose POW?
Well, I had a good experience in VQ2 in Rota, Spain, and then as I was getting ready to cycle to the next duty station, everybody had an option to put in for the next duty station that they wanted. The squadron I was in, VQ2, is a fleet reconnaissance, electronic, spies in the sky kind of thing. And there are only four squadrons of that, two on the East Coast and two on the West. The ones on the West Coast were pretty much based in Guam or Japan, and I didn't care for going that far over the Pacific, operating over there. And usually you had to do a flight duty, like I did in the squadron there, and then you go to land-base, then you go back to flying, then you go back to land-base. So I researched what was available, what was coming up for duty assignments, and I saw that, and I thought, well, I didn't know much about it, so I just got asking a couple other guys if they heard about it, and a lot of the pilots had been through the school, and they said, yeah, it was a pretty neat experience to go through that, but they wouldn't want to do it again, so I thought that was intriguing, and that just kind of piqued my interest, and I signed up for it. Luckily, I don't know if anybody put in a word for me or not, but I was lucky enough to get my selected duty assignment there at the POW school, which I really enjoyed that.
Now, after you got out of the service, did you become a pilot?
Yeah, after I got out of the service, I thought I was done with flying, so I just went home. My father-in-law had been very ill. We didn't know if he was going to live, so I decided to move back to Effingham, Illinois, to be closer to the family there for my wife and us. And I had an option to stay in Brunswick, Maine. They wanted me to stay at the survival school as a civilian, because we did have a civilian on staff too. And I wanted to stay there. I really would have, if my father hadn't been sick, we would have stayed there because my wife enjoyed that too. But we came back to be closer to the family, and that's 2 years I worked in the post office, of all things. That's a career change. And then I wasn't very happy doing that. My wife said one day, why don't you go out to the airport and see what's available? Just quit griping about life and go see what's out there. Flying is what you love. So I went out to the local airport in Effingham, Illinois. The guy had just started a new charter operation, and I signed on pretty quick. And then flew charter and corporate here in Effingham for, I think it was 4 years. And then I was in Louisville, Kentucky one day, and there were five white airplanes taxiing on the runway out for takeoff. 727s, all painted white with just a blue circle on the tail. And I thought, well, what is this? I've never seen that before. So I got to asking the people there at the airport, what's that? And they go, oh, that's UPS. They're trying out this overnight package stuff like FedEx, but they don't want anybody to know in case it doesn't work for them. So I got intrigued in that, started making some phone calls and found out who was in charge of that. And the company in Raleigh, North Carolina was doing their supplying their airplanes and pilots for them at the time. So, like the rest of my Navy career, I got lucky enough to get an interview with them, got hired within 2 weeks of the interview, and I was a pilot for them for 3.5 years, supplying services for UPS. Then in 1988, UPS did their own stuff in-house. It took all the airplanes and hired their own pilots and mechanics and all that, started up their own airline. So I was one of the first 100 hired at UPS in 1988, and I was a captain for them on the 727 for 20 years. In my last 4 years of my career with them, I flew on the Airbus A300, which is one of the big heavy wide bodies. That's where I ended my career. I retired in July of 2009 from UPS after those years, about 24 years of that. Now I'm retired and just enjoying myself.
Did you join any military organizations?
I was a member of the VFW for a while, and I'm a continuing member of the American Legion. I'll probably always be a member of the American Legion. I volunteer now for honor guard duty during the funerals for veterans. We show up at the cemetery and do the gun salute for them and honor the family that way.
Is there anything else you'd like to say?
Mm. I guess I can just say hello to my family in the future with this. How's that? That's all I have. Thanks.
Well, I'd like to say thank you for your time. And thank you for allowing me to be the one that interviewed you today. I greatly appreciate that.
Cheryl, I enjoyed visiting with you. Thank you.
Thank you.